Paul, Peter, Peter, Paul.
Oh, yes.
No, Mary.
So.
Okay.
You broke out as a teenage actor in LIE 16 years ago, and now you have, as your protagonist in your first film, an actor who's not too far from your own age when you started yourself, Ed Oxenbould. How did your own experience inform your work with him?
I was so excited to work with Ed because I did feel like, I can give them an experience. It felt, and I also agree, sort of interesting that, you know, I started out, my first film was sort of a kid being thrust into adulthood and confused, and now I'm making one, I mean, very different than LIE.
Right. Sure.
It felt really important to me, like, that Ed is a voice in the film, that he's a collaborator, that he's not just a kid. And to sort of just make the playing field as level as possible, like, Ed, what do you think, you know, and to be vulnerable in front of him and say, gosh, I don't know about this, or I'm nervous about this, Ed, what do you think, you know, or Carrie and Jake, and we were so lucky with Ed because he's a real actor. You know, I remember Zoe and I seeing his audition tape and going, like, gosh, he's really good, like, you think he's a real actor, like, he's had a DOS, the space in between the lines is filled out in his internal life, and having Ed allowed me to make the film I wanted to make. You know, I didn't have to cut around his performance. Mm-hmm. Carrie and Jake didn't have to act around him. All four of us kind of got to go to work together.
Yeah. And it's also an opportunity for him to really take his work to another level. Not that he hasn't been good before, but...
Sure. Yeah. I mean, he's definitely... Carrie and Jake are really good actors, and it's... in some great scenes with them, and they brought it all, and Ed was right there.
So let me take a step back and ask, do you recall when it first entered your mind that you wanted to make a film?
At some point. I've certainly had an interest in it for a long time. So even in high school, I'd taken some classes on film in the city, in New York, animation, and so I'm kind of just like, okay, well, is there anything else? Because I was already starting to act. And then probably when I really got, LIE was actually kind of my exposure to American independent cinema. I didn't really watch film before that. I mean, I did, but just as like a, you know. And suddenly going to Sundance, going to the festivals throughout the year, I started to see a lot of movies that I was like, okay, well, there's like, this is exciting. There's some films that are really cool, and then that led to eventually getting into foreign cinema as well. And that is probably really what blew the doors open to being like, oh, like there's a huge world of film, and the medium is so exciting. And so probably proper, like, oh, I think I want to direct. You know, probably more around 20 years old.
What was your path to wildlife being the one? When did you first encounter the book? When was the first time it occurred to you, oh, not only do I love this book, but this book is what I want to make as my first film?
Yeah, I mean, certainly I sort of wish like I had discovered something sooner. You know, like I wanted to, but this was a book I read. I was a fan of Richard Ford's. I saw him shelf in the bookstore. I read the first paragraph, and it remains one of my first paragraphs, my favorite first paragraphs ever. The language, and I was just like, oh god, can't, you know, totally gonna buy this book. Probably in 2011, I read it for the first time, and immediately felt a sort of uncanny personal relationship to it. The characters, the sense of love in this really great struggle, and even though there's a lot of pain, like he somehow wrote about this very difficult situation with a great amount of compassion, and the sense of the American dream, and then even stylistically, something in the kind of leanness of the prose, the spareness, like the poetry comes from the simpleness of it almost, and that's really reflective of who I think think I am a little bit, or what I want to, you know, so it really, it just lent itself to me in many ways. So I daydreamed about it for about a year, and then, because there were things that wouldn't work in a book and a film, and it's like, could I do it? And it's largely internal, first person, you know, and he's looking back on the experience. And when I thought of the ending, is when I thought, okay, I can actually really do this. So I wrote to Richard Ford an option book.
And Richard Ford did that thing you always hope an author will do if you're a filmmaker, which is to give you carte blanche to say, the book it'll always be on the shelf, you're going to make a film, it needs to be your film.
Yeah.
Can you talk about, once you had that go-ahead, what were the elements from the book that to you were just non-negotiable, the film needed to have those, and what were some of the ways in which you did liberate yourself?
Well, I mean, a lot of it's there, and you know, I mean, it's... I mean, these characters come from him in his book first, you know, and then they're put through me and Zoe, and then through Carrie and Jake and Ed. And, you know. There was a lot of challenges. One, it's how do you make the, sort of what the book made me feel into an image or an action. And because I didn't want to use voiceover immediately, again, it's looking back, so it would be very easy to, because the prose is beautiful, to use voiceover, it's very tempting, but I wanted to see, let's try at least to make the film present tense. Let's try to keep the weight of like memory in the image, you know, so it could be a memory piece, but let's just not say it is. Let's, you know, start present tense. Let's experience this with the kid. Luckily, Zoe and I optioned it ourselves, so we didn't have anybody to answer to. And I think time was really one of our greatest allies on this project because it allowed the script to become itself. If we had had to have written it in 6 months and gone and made it, it would have been more closer to the book, and it just wouldn't have been as, I don't want to say it's mature, I just mean it wouldn't have been its full self yet.
Sure.
So by taking our time, it just sheds skins, you know, and you start to let go of things, you start to go, you know what, characters, it needs this, like, you just start to follow the scent, and there was many roadblocks, you know, times where you're, luckily I had a good partner, too.
It's a very unsettling movie, obviously, in a lot of ways. I mean, there is that love that you talked about that's always there, that sort of allows you to maybe navigate the film without going nuts. But it is a sort of slow motion horror movie watching this child so powerless, seeing his parents, and the audience right with him, right, because we're seeing it through his eyes, seeing his parents walk up to these alarming choices and not having any recourse. And worse, the notion of them putting the emotional baggage on him, which is a hallmark of divorce, really, right?
Yeah.
The kind of competitiveness that goes on there.
Yeah.
Can you talk about what I guess what drew you to telling that story? You have talked about how personal it is. How does that resonate with your own experience? And how did you and Zoe approach telling that?
Well, I think one of the first things I felt was just like the mystery of who our parents are, and sort of that feeling of when you see you get older, like you just start to see your parents behave differently.
Yeah.
And sort of that's, it's a lot, you know, they're babies when they're born are completely helpless, and parents are, whether they're your heroes or whatever they are, but they're your life source, you know.
Right. Yeah.
So to kind of discover that they have a past, that they have a problem, or that they mess up, you know, I just felt, you know. And for me, I hope that family, I do agree that the film does take it to a place that, you know, it can be hard, but I just feel like a lot of people have of struggle where, you know, whether it's divorce or separation or loss of job and the pressure that puts on a family and the economic pressure families face and how that impacts a marriage and a home. And then Zoe and I don't know. I do agree that, you know, the film opens with a purposefully sort of an idyllic image, right? I mean, it's and that is something that's it's a family portrait, right, in the film. And so even thinking about a painting of Norman Rockwell painting, or when I see photographs, even you think about the way Instagram works now, people are just like, hey, I'm happy, and this is great.
Right.
Like, we all have, like, some, you know, like, we have full lives, you know. And so this idea of, like, just peeling back the layers, and then saying also at the same time, like, well, we all have something.
Yeah.
You know, when we see the portraits of other people, or kind of when we pop outside of the house, you know, it's like, oh, your neighbor, this might be your neighbor.
Yeah.
You know, I remember in high school hearing things suddenly about a family that, wait, but they seem so happy.
Right.
You know, and I don't know, like, what's inside the home is,
So, you mentioned earlier striving for a simplicity, and I know you also have talked about wanting to have an economy with the camera, not too much movement, and I think that's very effective in the film. There's a couple of moments that stick out as moments when you chose movement.
Mm-hmm.
For example, when he's outside the house, Bill Camp's house, we see him looking through the window, and then there's a suspenseful moment there, and it's always worse in your mind,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And then when the camera pans over, you know, because it plays on his reaction, which is so horrifying,
mm-hmm.
when the camera pans over, it's bad, but it's maybe not as bad as you might have imagined.
Mm-hmm.
And then also the scenes with the bus, the way movement works there, though it's maybe more so the movement in the frame. The way that the bus reveals almost like a curtain pulling back, you know, what's going on. Can you talk about those choices, when it made sense to you to have that kind of movement?
Great, yeah. So that's certainly, and you know, I felt, let's move the camera when it's necessary, like when you feel it, you know.
Yeah.
And same with even a real close-up, you know. I mean, there's a lot of portraiture, but like, I just sort of, like, I want those things. I was hoping that those things would have meaning when they happened, you know. And I also like stillness as a means of allowing a certain complexity almost, by not over telling you, you know. So if I, like, if you're reacting to something I do and it's like a quick cushion and you come off it, it's kind of like one thing. It's like, this is, you know,
yeah.
Where, like, hopefully, like, you know, Carrie is giving you, like, so much more than that if you just, you know, are present with her. Totally. That bus scene, actually, I think was written into the script that way. I don't know why, except that it felt to hear for him to be gone and interview, I don't know, it just felt good.
Yeah.
You know, it felt worth it in that moment. I really liked that scene. It felt cinematic to me. You know, it felt like the right way to represent that moment.
Yeah.
A simple answer.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about the title implies a certain commentary on human nature and how we like to think of ourselves as being above the animals, but really we have an animal nature too. We have this sexual drive that pushes us. We have this survival instinct. So can you talk a bit about what the title means to you and how you wanted to subtly explore that idea?
Yeah.
If I'm not putting words in your mouth.
No, I mean, I think that's one, you know, I mean, for me,
the wildfires as well.
Totally.
The relationship with it.
I just loved, I think it's, to me, it's about some things are just out of our control, too. And I think sort of what goes off inside of these parents, it is mysterious like nature. It's just a little bit bigger than them. it's like a crisis of identity for Jeanette, I think, in some way. And so, you know, and I just, well, I love the title of the book, and I also felt like, you know, as soon as we got to the other room, I was like, oh, yeah, if we put the title over the house, I don't know, it just felt right, you know. But yeah, for me, I suppose, and same with the setting, Montana, and, you know, being sort of on the edge of the, not the world, but like,
it feels like,
you know. So there's something about taking us, that their home is small, square footage wise, but, it, you know, it, what happens is that it's really big. And so something about that and the setting and the fires and nature, I guess that's wildlife.
If I can squeeze in one more question, that's, I didn't get the chance to talk to you about Love and Mercy, and I'm a huge Brian Wilson fan.
Me too.
So I wonder, you know, if you have a story that sort of encapsulates your experience of meeting him and getting to know the man mm-hmm. in that process.
Well, I loved getting to hang out with him. It's definitely one of the best times I've ever had acting. And I just love the music. I'm trying to think, because I haven't thought about it in a while. No, I mean, you know, we had it, Brian has like a, there's a lot of like stories around him, and connections and sort of, you know, mythology. And one cool thing that happened once was he came to watch a scene, and the next day the footage for that scene came back from the lab with a white light through the footage, and only the scene he was there for.
Huh.
And the lab couldn't explain it, DP couldn't explain it, and we had to reshoot it. And it's just one of those strange things where it's like, why did that happen the only time Brian was there?
Huh.
You know, for those of us who got really deep into the world of it, it felt like, you know, that is Brian. He's kind of got this halo.
Yeah. Certainly an aura, yeah. All right, well, it's been a great pleasure talking with you about the film. Great luck with the